Thank you for joining us for another power-packed message from Dr. Myles Munroe, provided by Munroe Global Incorporated and MunroeGlobal.com. We transform followers into leaders and leaders into agents of change. We hope that this message is a blessing to you as you advance your life and discover your purpose. Now, let's go into the message.
I want to talk about keys to building a stable faith. I'd like to begin this morning with the questions that always plague life. I call them the mysteries of life. And here's one I think that you need to write down. There are questions in life we can never answer. First, you must settle that. Because if you don't come to that conclusion, you will always be depressed. There are questions I will never be able to answer. Number two, there are things in life we can never explain. Settle that now. When you want an explanation for everything, you will always be depressed. Number three, write this down. There are things in life we can never change. Weeping, worrying, wailing, don't change some things except your blood pressure. So settle it in your heart. There's some things you cannot change. Number four, there are things in life you cannot control. Settle it. If this man wants to leave you, you can put a gallon of oil on his pillow and pray in tongues a million days. If he wants to leave you, that's his will. You can't control it. Get settled in some things in life. This woman wants to take drugs. She's your sister, you love her, but you can't control her going back to the base house. There's some things you can't control. You got to settle it. Question number five. There are things in life we cannot stop. So what you do is you make arrangement for it to pass you. Let me say that again. There's some things you cannot stop. So you make arrangement for it to pass you. Because if you can't stop it and you get in front of it, it will still go where it's going, but you'll be destroyed. Number six, there are things in life we are not responsible for. Say it and write it down. You sent your child to college. You paid the tuition. You tried your best, and they still came out and did some dumb things. You could not be responsible for that child's decisions. Settle it. Number seven, there are things in life we cannot exceed. And this is an important one because sometimes we think that we are all of that. One of my favorite statements in life that have kept me at peace is this one. I don't know. Say it. Say it again. That's the most powerful statement you can make in life. There are some things that exceed you. Goes beyond me, and it keeps me peaceful. So how do you face life with all these questions? Here's a thought. The key to life is a couple of things. Number one, knowing what is your limitation. You got to know your limitation. If you believe that you are more than you are, then the Bible says you are not wise. You got to know where the line is drawn, when you got to stop, when you can't go no further, when you can't get beyond something, you got to know your limitations. And my limitations keep me peaceful. Success in life, write this down, is when you know what you are responsible for. You know some things that you are responsible for. For example, your own decisions. You cannot blame anyone for something you decided. You have to know your responsibility. But number three is important. You also got to know what is your responsibility and what is not your responsibility. There are some things I discovered that even God doesn't take responsibility for. Like controlling your will. God died on the cross for you. Gave his life for us. Shed his blood for our redemption, went to hell on our behalf, took the keys of death, hell, and the grave, came back out of the tomb, rose again, and he still cannot save us without our permission. He knows his limitation. It is self-imposed. He knows what he won't cross. He will never violate your will. So we got to know what we are not responsible for. And this one is, next one is very important. You got to know what you cannot do. Listen, sometimes your children do dumb things. You shouldn't walk around for 40 years feeling guilty about that. They're old enough now. Write this down, please. And this is what I have come to save my life 30 years ago. Everybody say, let God be God. Say it loud. Say it louder. Say God loud. Let God be God. Do you know what the greatest temptation in human life is? Attempting to be God. We have the greatest temptation to be God. Now, we are gods, but we ain't God. Let me tell you what I mean by that. There are things only God can do. Write that down. This message comes right from God to you today. There's some things only God can do. Settle that. Number two, there are things only God knows. You will never know everything God knows. And there's some things God knows that he won't tell you. Why? It ain't none of your business. It's God's business. You don't know what God knows. So let God know what he knows. And what you know, you deal with what you know. That's all you want to deal with, is what you know. What you don't know, let God know that. Amen. That keeps you peaceful. Number three, let God be God. Why? There are things only God understands. And I know you probably said that many times, but it's true. God understands some things only he understands. That's why I go to sleep. I remember one time I was up worrying about something. This is over 30 years ago. I dealt with this 30 years ago. And the Lord says, look, two of us ain't got to be up. Spoke to me just clearly. He says, two of us ain't got to be up. I don't slumber, so you sleep. I went to bed. Tell your neighbor, don't sweat it. Go to sleep this week. Number four, write this down. There are things only God can explain. Friends, if you try to explain things only God can explain, you're going to become yourself an explanation. An explanation mark. The greatest thing you could ever say when you start dealing with God is, I don't know. This little finite brain that grew up in McCullough Corner tries to argue with God. Are you crazy? You from an island 2 miles wide. You can talk to the God who rules 500 million galaxies. How dare you? Yeah, but we love to argue with God. There's some things only God could explain. So go to bed. And some of you are putting yourself under unnecessary pressure, trying to explain things only God could explain. Relax your brain and go eat a good sandwich. Let God be God. Why? Because you got to know your limit. You only know what he allows you to know. And he don't allow you to know too much. Because your mental capacity to contain God's vast knowledge is impossible. So God gives us sentences. And he has a library. And this sentence can last your lifetime. I put this to you. That what God is after is strong faith. Now, I'm going to drive this home today, and God's going to heal your mind. Everybody say strong faith. Write this down, please. Your faith is only as strong as the test it survives. Listen to me. I am the shepherd of this flock. Y'all listen to me. Don't read no newspaper. Don't listen to nobody. God sent me to talk to you. Your faith is only as strong as the test it survives. That's what he told me to tell you. It's amazing. So how strong are you? You are only as strong as what you can lift. Comprende? Yeah. In other words, for you to know your strength, you gotta find something to test it. So you can never brag on your strength unless you test it. So many of you are walking around for years, singing hallelujah, dancing up here, shouting, testifying, coming up at the microphone, telling how good God is. And then God said, let me see how strong they are. The Lord is good. You might say, yeah, let me test that scripture in your life, God says. My God shall supply. And then God takes everything from you to see if you believe he supplies. He tests to see if you think you're strong. How strong are you? Well, you're only as strong as the test you survive. That's why God sent me to your life today. Because you got to understand, first of all, what is your motive for following God? Write that down, please. This is the heart of life. What is your motive for calling Jesus your Lord and entering the kingdom? Why did you come into the kingdom of God? What motivated you? Because your motivation will be tested. John chapter 6, I thought it was important to share something with you. It says in verse 24 of John 6, when the people therefore saw that Jesus was not there, neither his disciples, they also took shipping and came to Capernaum seeking Jesus. Everybody say, seeking Jesus. You know, everybody wants to look for Jesus. They say he can help you. He can pay your bills. He can pay your mortgage off. He can heal your body. He can cast out demons out of your life. He can help your children. He can save your marriage. He can. And so we go looking for him, even if it takes a ship. They were looking for Jesus. Watch this. It says in verse 25, and when they had found him. Hey, boy, say, I found him. So if you're born again, that means you found him. When they had found him on the other side of the sea, they said unto him, Rabbi, where did you come from? In other words, we were looking for you. We found you finally. Jesus answered, you seek me not because you saw the miracles, but because you did eat fish and bread. Crowds looking for Jesus. Massive ministry, big church, everybody looking for Jesus. Jesus, I know why you're all coming. You ain't looking for me. You're looking for a blessing. Fish, bread, free fish, and free bread. See, the day before, they had just gotten free whale sandwiches. Oh, don't we love God to bless us? Just anoint us, Lord. Just bring everything, God. The Lord promised he will bless us. He will add things to me. Yeah, he said, but you're looking for me, not for me to add things to you because you love me. What if I don't add today? He said, look, yes, I know you're looking for me, but I know why. Your motive is you want the good things from me only, and you want them free. You want a free life in Christ. You want to be blessed. And then he answers them. He says, look, work not for the meat which perishes. Don't use your faith on things that can go away in the morning. He says, but for meat which endureth how long? Unto everlasting life, which the Son of Man shall give unto you, for him God the Father had sealed. The only thing that is sealed in life is Christ. Sometimes we only follow God because he blesses us. We don't follow God. We believe in God because people live. Do you believe in God because people die also? God's kingdom is so strong. Nothing can move it. I put it to you. Watch him in the book, John 6, 28. Then they said unto him, what shall we do then that we might work the works of God? Okay, Jesus, so what should we do? Since we shouldn't follow you for bread and for fish and for what we can get from you, what should we do? He says, okay, let me answer you. Watch this. He said, this is the work of God. Simple. That you believe on him whom he sent. Don't believe on the bread. Don't believe on the fish. Don't believe on the miracles. Don't put your faith in the activities of God, because he might not act sometime. He says, the greatest work that you can do is belief. Everybody say belief. Say it loud. The word belief, write it down, belief, is the word Jesus used here, P-I-S-T-I-S. Write it down. Believe. Pistis. P-I-S-T-I-S. It's the exact same word as faith. Write it down. Faith. Belief, pistis, faith. He says the greatest work you can do in life is to have faith in the one God sent. Not the things he does. Remember now, he said, I know why you're following me. Your motive is what you can get. And as long as things are going good and I'm giving you fish and bread, then you want to come follow me. He said, but forget the stuff. I want you to follow and believe in me, not the fish, not the bread. He's shifting our motivation from things to him, because things change. Are you following this? It's very important. Now he goes on to close this thing. I love this. He says, our fathers did eat, the people talking now, our fathers ate manna in the desert. As it's written, he gave them bread from heaven. Now, what are they talking about? They said, look, in the past, we had many miracles, man. Yes, sir, God saved this one. God healed that one. God redeemed that one. God delivered that one. That was in prison, and God brought that one out of prison. God did this. He said, come on, Jesus, God did a lot of things. And they're giving Jesus Christ a report card on what he did. They were trying to convince him that the reason why we follow Moses is because of the miracles. But Jesus answered. Jesus said unto them, truly, truly, I say unto you, Moses gave you not that bread that came down from heaven. Why? Because the miracles are temporary. The mortgage payment is temporary. Do you know God could actually bless you with a car and then next week take it away? Because the car is temporary. Why? The car didn't come from heaven. It came from Ford. And God can provide the bank payment, or God can test you and see if you can have peace if you miss a payment. He's God. We don't know what he's thinking. Christ says, therefore, you put your faith not in the things of God, but in the God of the things. Watch him now. He says, but my Father giveth you the true bread that came down from heaven. Now, wait a minute. So there's two kinds of bread here in life. There's bread, that's the blessings. Then there's another bread that came down from heaven. Let's read what that bread is. Verse 34. Then they said unto him, Lord, even more, give us this bread. He answered them, I am the bread. Ladies and gentlemen, are you following Jesus Christ or are you following BFM? Is your faith in Jesus Christ, the bread from heaven, or is it in the blessings you get, the bread from earth? Let me tell you something, my friends. I speak to you as a senior pastor. If anybody should acquit the ministry, it's me. You don't know my story. The secret harassment, phone calls, letters from pastors, threats, and I had to make it through. It's been 39 years, and I'm still standing. You've been saved for 10, and you call it tough. Listen, you are only as strong as what your faith survives. Please don't disappoint me now. Don't tell me that all my teaching for 50 years or 30 years or 20 years is going to be knocked over by an incident. Where is your faith? It's in God, the bread that came down from heaven. Look what he says. He says, he that cometh to me and eat me shall never hunger. I was thinking this morning, listen carefully, please. On the way here on the aircraft flying in, I was thinking, my mind was racing. Holy Spirit was just speaking to me so loud. He said, do you know that when me and the disciples went on the ship, the little boat, he said, do you know that I am God? I can do anything. He said, do you know I could have prevented the storm? Come on, look at me. Look, this is very important. He says, I could have stopped the storm from starting rather than stopping it after it started. Either way, I'm God. I could stop the wind before it blew or let it blow and then stop it. He said, doesn't matter. I could have stopped it. He said, but I set it up. I set it up because it wasn't about me. It was about these three guys who I was testing to trust with the church. I had to trust them to see if they could handle a little bit of pressure. And he said, to make sure they couldn't look at me, I went to sleep. Do you feel like God sleeping on you right now? I say, you feel like God sleeping on you? Where's God? Because I'm in the boat, but I'm sleeping. I'm still in the boat, but I'm snoring. I got one eye open, checking how you reacting to the storm. Come on, somebody. And the Bible says when they woke him up, he did not stop the storm first. And that's where we are right now. He has woken up. He sent me because he's awake. And the question he asked them was, where is your faith? The storm is not the problem, he says. Your faith is only as strong as the problem it survives. He attacked them. He said, where's your faith? You can let a storm take away your peace. And the Prince of Peace is on board. And they were ashamed. He said, I really sent this, allowed this storm. Not sent, but allowed it to happen. Just to see your reaction. What kind? You all tell me you believe in me. You tell me that you're my disciple. You tell me that I am your God. I am your Messiah. He said, okay, let me see if you believe that I really am the Messiah. I'm going to go to sleep while there's a storm going on. You got faith in the storm or in the Messiah? And when the lesson was over, he stopped the storm. Whatever you're going through right now in your personal life is allowed by God. Now notice my words. I didn't say he generated it. It's allowed. The Bible says he will not allow you to be tempted beyond that which you are able to overcome. Which means that the test is equal to the faith. You should clap your hands right there, Myles. You missed the whole revelation. If the test is big, that's what he thinks about you. Let me tell you something. The size of the test is God's way of saying, I believe this about you over other people. Glory, hallelujah. I say hallelujah. The bigger the test, the bigger the faith he got in you. He did not stop the storm until their faith survived it. My friends, he says, he that believeth on me shall never thirst. The water Moses gave you is temporary. The blessings you had is temporary. Ladies and gentlemen, we preach that the kingdom of God will meet your needs. Absolutely true, and Jesus did it. He paid their mortgages, he paid their taxes, he caught fish for them, all that was fine. But they got excited about the fish and the taxes. And he said, no, forget what I gave you, believe in me. You don't follow God because what you can get, your faith. Kingdom faith is in the king, not in the king's favor. Kingdom faith is in the king, not the king's gifts. Wherein is your faith? Watch this, John 6:53. I want you to read this now. Please don't be among these, okay? It says, then Jesus said unto them, I say unto you, truly, truly, except you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Have anyone ever said this to you? Well, if God is so good, why is this happening to you? See, he's answering it. He says, look, he says, your relationship with God ain't got nothing to do with what's happening to you. I'm going to say it again. Your relationship with God has nothing to do with what's happening to you. Could you imagine how Daniel felt? He's standing before the king, Nebuchadnezzar. And Nebuchadnezzar said, you know something? I'm going to put you in the lion's den. Let him eat you. And Daniel started praying in tongues. He expected an angel to come. No angel showed up. He expected him to be vanished from the sight of this court. No vanishing took place. They put a chain on Dan. Dan figured, okay, God can catch me halfway down the hall. He can reduce the chain. God didn't show up. Where is my God? The one I told the king about. And then he heard the growlings of the lions down there in the den. And he figured God going to catch me just before the door opens. He's going to snatch me away, rapture. And then the door opened. No God. And then he walks inside. All the lions start circling him. And he figured God's going to make me vanish. And he doesn't vanish. Where is God? See, Daniel had to shift his trust from the works of God to God.
Amen.
If your faith is in God, it doesn't matter what happens around you, God is stable. Amen. Give God a big clap. Give him praise. He never shifts and moves. He's the same yesterday, the Bible says. He says, if you don't eat my flesh, don't eat the bread, the stuff I give you, eat me. Don't drink the water. Drink me, he says, my blood. He said, if you do that, then you will have life. You'll be able to live through anything. Let me give you something to think about. You're going to go through some more difficult things in the next few years. So brace yourself. This message is to prepare you for next month, next year, 5 years from here. You're going to remember, oh, Pastor Myles said that the test comes to test my faith. I'm going to stand. And after standing, I will stand. How strong are you? You are as strong as what your faith survives. I have no fear of things getting the best we've ever seen. God's going to do some things to show off, but he check in everybody. One time the Lord told me, he says, look, he says, some people can't even survive success. Your faith couldn't survive $1 million. You forget about God. You go buy a car and boat and house somewhere and just enjoy yourself, play golf. God says, wait a minute, you can't handle success. And so he withdraws everything from you. You know what Jesus said? I quote his words. He says, if you've been faithful over little first, let me test you with little. Then I'll trust you with more. It depends on whether you can manage the little first. Can you manage a little stress problem, a little period of lack? Or do you start saying, God ain't working? Do you know how many things I had to wait 10 years for God to do? And you want it in 10 days. As if you know everything God knows. God knows you can't handle it in 10 days. Because you ain't got the matured faith to handle it. Many times you think God didn't answer your prayer. No is an answer. Clap, praise God. Yeah, your seven-year-old girl come to you and say, Daddy, I want the car keys, and I want them now. What are you going to say to this seven-year-old? No. That's a prayer. She's praying. I pray thee, let I have it the key. And your prayer, knoweth. No. That's an answer to prayer. Why? Tell me why you said no. Come on, tell me why. To protect the child. How many times you talk, God didn't hear you, and he was protecting you. Everybody say he knows everything. So when you don't know, trust what you know about him. He knows everything. That's why James wrote in his book, he says, always write, he says, if the Lord wills. In other words, I'm coming to see you, Pat. If the Lord wills, because he might want me to see you. You can make a plan, because you know something? I got a bigger picture of this thing. That's the wrong timing to see her. I remember that time I got left in Atlanta. Plane left me. We arrived like, 30 minutes too late. Plane left me. I was so upset because I wanted to come home and I was away for 7-8 days. I was angry. The plane just, that some storm or stuff messed up my whole plan. And I'm upset in the airport. And the Lord spoke to me, He said, shut up and sit down. So I shut it up. And I sat down. And I'm sitting there now, trying to figure, okay, all right, I'm sitting down. What now? And I heard someone call my name. And it was this guy walking down the airport. He says, I know you. You on TV. You Dr. Munroe? I said, yes, sir. He said, I'm so-and-so-and-so. He shook my hand. I said, well, good to meet you. Yes. Come to find out, he was the guy who was going to publish my book. He was the publisher. He said, I was looking for you for months. He found me when a plane was missed. Now the books are in 80 countries. Sometime God will give you an accident to give you a revelation. He knows everything. God shipwrecked the boat Paul was on. Is your boat shipwrecked at the moment? Do you feel like the whole thing shipwrecked? Yeah, it's a setup. He wanted to see if you could handle snakes. Where's your faith? Please write this down. Very important verse, John 6. Please read this carefully. He says, and many, therefore, of his disciples, when they heard what he said, they said, this is a hard saying. He wants us to eat his flesh and drink his blood. In other words, he wants us to follow him without guarantee of fish and bread. He's crazy. The reason why I follow you is because I want fish and bread. You telling me, forget the fish and bread. Eat you? Are you crazy? In other words, your pastor's telling you today, God is saying, don't follow me for what I could give you. Follow me for me. And if I don't give you, you still follow me. When you're going to eat, eat me. Glory Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise God. He says, your faith should not be in what I give you, but the thing that gave it to you is me. Look at him. They say, this is a hard saying. You want us to just trust God for nothing. Boy, that's tough. Everything that you have, you will lose. You hear me? Ain't nothing permanent. I settled that years ago. My wife will die one day. I got to get used to the idea that I might have to live without my wife. You see, Sister Charia, she's a blessing to me. Her husband was an awesome gift to this church. We prayed and fasted. We splashed oil on him. We prayed. God said, no. He did what he's supposed to do. And she's standing strong in the faith because she knows God knows things she doesn't know. When you don't know what to do, you trust God. I'm going to say this again because some of you ain't got it in your head yet. Everything you have, you will lose. That's not a negative prophecy. David says some trust in chariots. Some trust in the sword. See, David had chariots. He tried it. And he lost some battles. He trusted in the sword. And he was defeated many times. He said, but when I put my trust in God, hallelujah, hallelujah. It didn't matter whether the battle was raging. I knew that the one I trusted is still the winner. Give God a praise. You're going to win no matter what happens around you. Bahamas Faith Ministries does not exist because of the good things that happen to his members. We exist because God raised up a vision in this nation to bless the world, and he's doing a good job. We should give him a praise. Hallelujah. Yes, I thank God for Mother Trotman. We lost her sitting in that chair right there. We lost her. But we're still standing, and she's clapping in the stand saying, go, Myles, that's my boy, go. Dr. Chara's still shouting. Pandora's still shouting, go, boy, go. Why? You ain't here forever either. We're going to bury you one day. You ain't going to stop the show because the show is not your show. Give God a praise. Hallelujah. This is a hard saying. Look at that. Boy, it's a hard message, Pastor Miles. You just want me to trust God? Let's see what they did. Next verse. It says, from that time, many of his disciples went back. Are you one of them? You are a fish sandwich Christian. Many of them went back. Why? Because he took away their bread and water and gave them his flesh and blood. He took away the gifts and he gave them to giver. They didn't want it. He took away salvation and gave them the Savior. They didn't want it. He took away the blessings and gave them the blesser. Where's your faith? Who is it in? Your faith is not in what happens to people in this ministry. There are folks sitting next to you right now who will disappoint you in a few years. They're going to do some dumb things. And if I was depending on the lifestyle of people in this ministry and the commitment that they promised me, I would have quit 1,000 years ago. But I am not leading this ministry because you are here. This is an assignment by my life from God. And God has given you one too to join this ministry to make it what it's supposed to be to impact the world. You're not here just to get fish and bread. You're here to change the world by feeding them the living bread. Come on, give God a praise. Hallelujah. May he bless your family because you put faith in him. Everybody say, trust in the Lord. Say it again, trust in the Lord. Read this verse again. It says, and many who followed him went back and walked no more with him. Sounds familiar? Notice Christ didn't panic. Matter of fact, watch what he says. Then he said unto the 12 who were left. Always some folks left, you know, faithful ones. He said, you won't go too? In other words, I'm not in this for y'all. Some people believe that if they leave you, you will become less. And they try to use that as a bargaining tool. And the Lord told me to leave. As if it's something special. He said, you want to go? Go. He told Peter, you want to go too? Go. I don't want no one around me for fish and bread. I want them around me for flesh and blood. Come on, give him a shout. Hallelujah. Put your faith in me, not my miracles. You want to go, he says. Is that how strong your faith is? It's as strong as missing a meal, fish and bread. No fish, no bread, no follow. That's what they're saying, no fish, no bread, no follow. My faith is as strong as fish and bread. If you don't bless me, I ain't coming, God. Boy, I wonder what Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego would say to you when you get to heaven. You lousy thing, you. We went into fire without him. We went into the fire hoping he would save us. And he showed up in the fire. He didn't protect us from the furnace. He didn't keep us from going in. He let us go in. We need some fire Christians. You're in the fire, so what? There's a fourth man around. He's right here this morning. Praise God. Holy Ghost is running up and down this building right now, shouting, preach, pastor, preach. He's telling me, preach. Why? Put your faith in God. I remember Shadrach told Meshach and the big Negro. He said, look. He said, let's tell the king this. You should read this in the book of Daniel. He says, look, if the Lord delivers us, fine. If he doesn't deliver us, fine. That's what they said. Is that the kind of faith you get? If we lose the house, I still trust God. If we keep the house, I still trust God. I dare you. I dare you. Where's your faith? Sometimes we get faith in faith and not faith in God. Verse 68. And then a member of BFM, Simons, answered him and said, Lord, to whom shall we go? In other words, look, where are we going? The words of life are with you, he says. We're getting the word here with you. Where are we going? An incident of missing a meal can't take us away from you. A lack of sandwiches will never remove us from you. When we don't get what we want and things don't work out the way we wanted it, we still ain't going nowhere. Why? Because we still ain't find nobody better than you, God. Let me tell you something. The folks who sometime will criticize you in the midst of a storm ain't got no God to go to. So why are you listening to them? Come on, give them a praise. You got a God to go to and to cast your cares upon. That's why I don't waste my time, because I ain't going to let no one punch me. My faith is in God. The storms that I've been through and that many of you have been through have prepared you for every other storm. So be faithful to God. Hallelujah. I said be faithful to God. Read the last part. It says, and we believe that you are surely the Son of God, the Christ. Notice what Peter did? He shifted from bread to belief in Jesus. I believe it was at this point where Jesus really took Peter in and said, I'm going to train you to be the next leader. Because Peter shifted from bread. Remember? First it was fish. He caught fish from Peter. And Peter says, I'll follow you, man. You keep my business going. What if he doesn't keep your business going? Remember now, the first catch of fish was a business deal. Peter's business was going good because Jesus provided resources for the business. His faith was in fish. Now it was in bread. And Christ says, no, not even bread. And now Peter shifts. He says, I believe in you. Is that where you are now? Let me tell you something. I discovered something about God. God is the rock. Say it.
God is the rock.
The Bible calls him the rock. You know the rock. Ladies and gentlemen, if you anchor on the rock, it doesn't matter the storm. Put your faith in the rock. Peter says, you the Christ, I believe. And Jesus answered them and says, have I not chosen you 12 and one of you? Even in these 12 is the devil. Ladies and gentlemen, listen to me. It's very important. I don't know who that might be in this room. And remember, he was close. He ain't one of the 70. He was in the top part of the ministry. Here's what's important about this. Jesus kept on going. I'm going to say it again. Jesus kept on going. It doesn't matter who's around you. He just kept on going. He said, the Father gave me work to do. I'm going to do the Father's work. Don't let people remove you from the Father's work. By the way, I think it's important to note that was the one who committed suicide. And Jesus kept on going. Say it. And Jesus kept on going. What stops your faith? Suicide of his personal friend could not stop him from going. I am sure Jesus felt that hurt because Judas was part of the team. He chose him. But he couldn't stop him. He couldn't stop from making private deals. I don't know what's going on in your house. Judas was making private deals on the side. What's going on in your house? You come as a member, people think you're fine. What's going on in your house? Now, they could have blamed Jesus and said, you know, Jesus, you caused him to commit suicide. Jesus said, don't put that on me. Jesus never took credit for it or responsibility. He says, Judas, do what you have to do. It's amazing. Whatever stops you is the strength of your faith. And so, Myles Munroe, Bahamas Faith Ministries, we're going to keep on going. And keep on going. And keep on going. Why? Because we come to finish the work he gave us to do. And he knows things we don't know. He can do things we cannot do, and he can explain things you could never explain. So just keep on going. Yeah. You know, some people in this room are living in the past, and it's weighing you down. You're still carrying load from people who hurt your feelings 10 years ago or disappointed you 5 years ago, and you ain't moving ahead. And God is saying, look, cut that off. And keep on going. You got a life ahead of you. You got things to accomplish, big things to do for God. Cut that thing off. We got to forgive people. And we got to bless them. And don't speak evil of them. And then keep on going. Don't try to second guess nobody's motive. What you don't understand, leave it to God. Put your trust in God and then keep on going. Let me tell you something in case you don't understand this. I figured it 30 years ago. Because when you leave, we can forget you. And we're going to keep on going. Listen, you ain't that important as you think you are. You know, let me tell you, sometimes you say, well, if I don't show up, ain't nothing going to happen. Oh, you'll be amazed. You will be amazed. Tell your neighbor, do your part. Do it well. And move on. That's all God wants you to do. Don't get all uptight about how important you are. You know, if I don't do this, then ain't nothing going to happen. Let me tell you something. God can get rid of me in the morning. Matter of fact, I have a blank sheet in my life right now. Whatever God says to do, I do. Hold on to nothing tight. Just keep on going. Let me close with this, please. Write this down. This is very important. I'm going to give you a list. Success is measured by your ability to maintain personal balance in times of turmoil. Maturity is your ability to manage the expected and the unexpected. I can tell you how matured you are by what you do under pressure. It doesn't matter how much you talk, how great you are. I check how you react under pressure, because that is the measure of your maturity. Those who are matured in the faith are willing to be tried in the furnace. Success in life is your capacity to manage turmoil and keep your balance in the middle of it. Hey, y'all, keep your balance. Christ is the same. I like what the Bible says. The Bible says God is light, and in him there is no darkness, nor any shadow of turning. He doesn't waver even an inch. He is steady. And then he says, imitate me like dear children. Be steady. We will stay steady because what is over our heads is still under his feet. What a blessing. How do you respond to tragedy is a measure of your maturity. You know, my brother, Paul, who grew up with me, he and I were like twins. He was 1 year older than me. We were together all the time. Matter of fact, his name was Paul, and we were so close, they ended up calling me Peter. So most of the folks who know me from a little boy knew that they called me Peter. Matter of fact, some folks didn't even know I was named Myles, because my brother and I were so close. Whenever they saw us, we were always together like a twin. He said, Peter and Paul, Peter and Paul, Peter and Paul. My brother died in my hands. I remember he told me, my brother had an accident. I sped up there, slam brakes, went to the road. Everybody on the side. I went to the road, man, there's blood. My brother's head, big hole in my brother's head. And I hold my brother. And I start praying, God, you can raise the dead. Raise my brother. And I buried my brother here. How can you handle tragedy? What do you do with tragedy? You keep on going. What will separate you from the love of God? I got an answer for you. Maybe it's death, life, demons, things present, things to come. What is your faith worth? And so I walked away from my brother's accident with his blood on my shirt. And I believe in God still. Because the God who allowed him to die could raise the dead. It's just that God decided he wasn't going to do it that day. God could stop people from doing anything. So whatever he allowed to happen has a bigger reason than you could ever understand. And if anybody, you hear me? If anybody thinks they're big enough to try and accuse you or explain something, I dare them. You know, God has a sense of humor. He'll put the plug on them and see how they react. The Bible says, judge that you be not judged. You start judging, God put the plug on you. See how you handle it. Thy will be done. What a beautiful prayer. Thy will be done. Because I don't understand the whole will. So thy will be done. Not my will, Jesus said. Thy will be done. I want this cup to go away. I don't want to go through the cross. Don't want to go through the pain and the whip and all the slapping and the spitting in my face. He said, but tell you what, whatever you will, no problem. What are you willing to go through with your faith. And I walked away with my brother's blood on my shirt. I had to go home and sit in the house and ask God. I preach that you are the resurrection. I preach that you're the healer. Why didn't you let my brother live? And the Lord says, you know, your parents had four sons. I only had one. And I let him die. Your parents still got three. My argument was over. I said, but God, my brother, he was born again, loved Jesus. Every time I went up there, he was reading the Bible. He was faithful to you. He gave tithes. He even paid tithes to BFM, God. He's a good God. God says, yes, my son never did anything evil either. And I let him die. Can you explain God? You want to argue with God? No. Though he slay me. Oh, Jesus. Boy, God did a job on Job. Let's read a few scriptures. And I want to pray for every family here. Hebrews 12, 28. Everybody read, go. Therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken, let us be thankful and so worship God acceptably with reverence and awe. He says that this kingdom we are in cannot be shaken. Everything else falls around it. Cannot be shaken. That's what I'm in. How about you? I'm in an unshakable kingdom. Praise God. Look at this one. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1 verse 3. Read. We ought always to thank God for you, brothers, and rightfully so, Paul says, because your faith is growing more and more, and the love every one of you has for each other is increasing. Therefore, among God's churches, we boast about your perseverance and your faith in all the persecutions and the trials you are under. He says, we tell everybody about how you make it through persecution. We boast about your faith. Not how big your building is. Not how many offerings you take up. We boast about how they handle persecution. Amen. You know, tears came to my eyes day before yesterday in Minnesota. I was being introduced to this auditorium of people by Langstaff. He said something to me, to the people. He said, you know, this young man, he said, in 1981, I went to the Bahamas and he had nothing. He says, and today, he's known all over the world. He said, and you know what's amazing? The same people that started with him are still with him. He said, we can trust this kind of faith. What a commendation. I'll never forget Corrie Ten Boom, that great woman who saved the Germans. I'll never forget her. She's dead now, praise God, but she went to heaven. She wrote that book called God's Trump. They made a movie out of her called The Hiding Place. Some of you saw that movie. I had lunch with her. She was 87 years old when I ate lunch with her in Tulsa. And I was so honored to be in the presence of a great woman. And I said, Miss Tenbone, if you could tell a young man something to help him, what would you tell me? And she answered me. I'll never forget. She said, she was from Holland, Dutch. She said, Myles, remember, just grow where you are planted. Changed my life. That's why I'm so steady. Tell your neighbor, I'm planted. Say it again, I'm planted. If your faith is only as strong as the problem, then that's the strength of your faith. He said, boast about your faith to everybody. And you're enduring. Look at verse 5. Read. All this evidence is that God's judgment is right. No, hold it. This is evidence. Wait a minute. You're going through persecution. Paul says, yeah, that's the Lord's judgment. Judgment means what is rightfully yours. That blew my mind. God said, look, I'm going to let them lay you off because you need to be laid off right now. Oh, God. God said, look, shut up. This is justice. For me to do what I want to do next, you got to get out of here. And right now, you ain't ready to leave. Apparently, you don't want to leave this place. So tell me, I'm going to shut the whole place down to get rid of you. Come on, clap your hands. God said, I got some knowledge you don't have no idea about. Shout hallelujah loud, somebody. Yeah. They want you to stay a pilot all your life. You, Captain Rose, stay a pilot. God said, no, I want you to run the country's aviation. So he shut doors. Justice. God saw everything this ministry would go through. before it even began. So he's prepared you for everything we're going through. My confidence is in God. Look at the next statement. Read. He says, therefore, as a result of what? Handling the tests and persecution and trials, you will be counted worthy of the kingdom of God for which you are suffering. He said, look, the only way for me to show the world, the other kingdoms, the quality of my kingdom is to show them how strong my people are. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So God allows in order to show off. Everybody's watching right now. How are they going to make it? We're going to see what they can do now. God said, no, no problem. These are kingdom people. They can handle anything. Can you? Yes, we can. Sounds familiar. You can tell those who watch the news. James 1. Everybody read? Go. Consider it pure joy. Consider it what? Pure joy. Why? My brothers, whenever you face trials of many kinds, not just one kind, read on, because you know that the testing of your faith develops perseverance. And perseverance must finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. Give God a hand for that scripture. Hallelujah. God is about to trust this ministry with some stuff he needs strong faith to handle. He's about to bring into our hands some stuff, obviously, that is so heavy and so awesome and so wonderful, he needs tested people to handle it. So he allows things to happen. Doesn't make things happen. He allows. Let me tell you something. This is very important. God don't watch the dead. I'm going to say this again. God ain't watching the dead. He's watching the living. Let me see what they can do. His eyes are upon the righteous. So what you going to do if your child dies, son? You get a message next week that your baby died in school. What you going to do? You can call your wife at the bank and say, honey, that's it. Let's forget God. God didn't save my daughter. Or do you go on and say, God, even though you slay my kid, where's your faith? He says, your testing is to purify your perseverance. Look at this next one. Moses killed an Egyptian and then became greater afterwards. Abraham slept with his maid and then became greater afterwards. What have you gone through? Joshua was delivered out of the hands of the desert, but God gave him Jericho test first. Daniel loved God, excellent spirit, went straight to the lion's den. David killed his own general in order to marry and commit adultery with the guy's wife. God made him write the largest book in the Bible. You going through some tests? How about this one? Job, poor guy. Wife, daughter, cow, and dog, dead. Farm, burned. Boy, no wonder why his name is spelled J-O-B. What a job. But God blessed him seven times more at the end because he made it through the test. Jesus, betrayed by his best friend who committed suicide. And after that, his resurrection was the most glorious, powerful event on earth. What happens after the test? It's always greater. Paul. It was Paul who gave permission to kill all the Christians in the book of Acts. And yet God took that serial killer and took the New Testament out of him. What tests will you survive? Your greatest moments are ahead of you. It's after the test. Peter The guy lied and cussed, denied Jesus. He was put in prison for preaching Jesus. He became the pastor of the church. It's greatest after the test. John, who was called the beloved of Jesus. This guy loved Jesus so much. He wrote the beautiful books, 1st, 2nd, 3rd John and the book of Revelation. Guess what? God put him on an island, marooned as a prisoner. I mean, what's your test like? What's your faith like? John closed his book by saying, he is King of kings and Lord of lords forevermore still. Even if I'm on an island marooned as a prisoner, my faith is in him, not the Roman government. How big is your faith? How strong is your faith? 1 Timothy says, my son, I give you this instruction in keeping with the prophecies once made about you, so that by following them, you may fight the good fight of what? You may fight the good fight of faith, holding to the faith and a good conscience. Some have rejected these and so have shipwrecked their faith. Among them are, and he calls them names, Hymenaeus and Alexander, whom I have handed over to the devil. Paul says, look, I had some folks who were with me and they couldn't handle the pressure. That's the Apostle Paul. He said, they were part of my group and I worked with them for years and then they couldn't handle the pressure. So I gave them over to the devil. That means they went back. He says, here's what I want to remind you of. This is a verse that changed my life. 1 Timothy 6:11. Read. But you, say it loud. But you, man, woman of God, flee from all of this and pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, endurance, and gentleness. Fight the good fight of faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called when you made good confession in the presence of many witnesses. Fight the good fight of what? 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 What's our fight? What kind of fight are we fighting? What's the real fight? You don't fight against the devil. What is faith? What is faith? Belief. The fight is for your belief. Do you still believe that God is with you? You still believe that God is with us? You still believe that God has called us? It's the fight for your faith. All you have in your life is faith. Once you lose that, you lost. I used to think I'm fighting the devil. It changed my life. The fight is for my belief. That's why the devil would do things to help you stop believing. It ain't against him. It's the belief. Once you got the faith, he's defeated. And so you're coming from prayer meeting on a Monday night. Had a great time. Oh, that was a wonderful service. Bam! Car hit something. Where's God? Didn't he tell me angels would be protecting me? And God's watching. Let me see what's going to happen. Still believe in me? The devil set something up. And God said, let me check. You know, I was reading the book of Job last night. And, oh gosh, you got to go back and read that book. The devil came before God. And the devil says, you see that man, Job? God says, yes. He only followed you because of the blessings you gave him. That's in Job. You gave him a wife and children and a farm and wealth. That's why he followed you. God said, tell you what. So what do you want me to do? Satan says, let me touch him and see if he still believes in you. That's the book of Job. So God says, okay, tell you what. You could touch him, but you can't kill him. Satan said, no problem. Some of y'all are there now. So he started taking away the cattle, kill all the cows. He kill all the sheep. He burned the barn. He kill all the children. His wife said to Job, you still believe in God? That was the question. We fight the good fight of what? Faith. Do you still believe? You ain't got no cow, no horse, no donkey, no farm, no money, no children. You're full of disease and boils. Do you still believe in God? Then she says, why don't you curse God? In other words, forget this Christian thing, this kingdom thing. Let me just quit this. Sound like Job's wife? And Job turned around to that woman. And I want you to turn around to everybody else too, from this day forward. Here's what happens when you come through the test. Everybody got it? Why don't you read this? This is for you. Job 42, here's how it ended. All the boils are gone, you know, all the cows and everything, all the house burned, everything. Watch how it ends. It says, and the Lord, verse 10, and the Lord restored the fortunes of Job. No, wait. I don't want to go there. I saw something last night that blew my mind. Okay, look at verse 7. This is for people who are talking to you right now. You know when you go out of here? Yeah. Watch this. Remember that Job had three friends? Yeah. And them three friends were talking bad about Job. Oh, you worship God. Look what happened to you now. Everybody ever heard that this last week? Yeah. What y'all gonna do now? That was the three friends. Those three friends. Watch this. Verse 7. And the Lord, after he had spoken these words to Job, the Lord said to this one of the friends, Eliphaz and the termite. Gotta watch them termites. They eat at you, you know. It's actually terminite, okay? It says, the anger of the Lord burned against them and against the two friends. For you have not spoken of me what is right, God says. In other words, you blame me for all this stuff, as my servant Job has. In other words, Job didn't blame me all through this. Where's God? How come God allowed this? He said, Job never said that. All of y'all said that. Watch this. Now, therefore, y'all take 7 bulls and 7 rams and go to my servant Job and offer up a burnt offering for yourselves, and my servant Job shall pray for you. I say, we got to pray for them people because they don't understand. Watch this. For I will accept his prayer on your behalf. Listen, don't attack nobody. Don't talk back. Tell them I'm praying for you. That's all. I pray. Because if you touch God, you might get kapunkle up. God's anger burns at those who attempt to explain what they don't know.
Amen.
Look at the next verse. He says, I will accept Job's prayer not to deal with you according to your folly, for you have not spoken of me with a right, what is right, as my servant Job has. So the friends who criticize him, Eliphaz and the termite, and Bildad the Shunite, and Zephora the Naamanite, all these ites, they went and did what the Lord had told them, and the Lord accepted Job's prayer for those people. Tell you what, let's pray for people, okay? People call me up and ask me what I think. I don't know. I know nothing. God's will be done. I'm going to keep on going. You accuse God, God will kill you. That's what he's talking about here. Oh, the story ends. Verse 10. And then the Lord restored the fortunes of Job when he had prayed for his friends. You want God to bless you? Pray for those who criticize him. You get your turnaround when you get the right attitude toward those who got bad attitude.
Amen.
Can I say it slow? You get your turnaround when you pray for those who got the bad attitude. Don't be defensive. You can't defend God. So you pray for people. Listen, he says, after Job prayed for them, his turnaround came. Keep the right attitude. Watch this. Then came, verse 11, then came to him all of his brothers and sisters and all who had known him before all the trouble. Okay, isn't that amazing? When things get rough, the brothers are scatter. Sisters gone. I ain't going back there. I tell you, don't go there. Yap. God said, don't worry. When this thing turns around and they see what I'm about to do, everybody show up. Hey, how you doing? Yeah, I'm back. See, your faith is as strong as the test it survived. They came back afterwards. Oh, I love it. And ate his bread. Mind the guy was, you know, down to zero. Now everybody comes to eat at his table with him in his house. He had host again. Come on, give me 5, man. I prophesy. Lift your hand. Prophecy, come here. I prophesy. Everything you lose through the test, you will not get it back. You can get it multiplied. Amen. Come on, give him a praise. You can get the same thing back. I feel like running right down there all by myself before I go home. You see, the devil has been telling you, now you're down now. You're down now. No, you ain't down. You're getting ready to rise so high, he ain't never going to be able to see you again. You're going to go so high. Tell your neighbor, make it through the test to a higher level. Come on, read this with me. This is powerful stuff. It says, and they showed him sympathy and comforted him for all the evil that the Lord had brought upon him. And each of them gave him a piece of money. All of a sudden, now the folks who criticize, they can start giving you things. Do you know what this means? Here's what it means. You only invest in what stands the test. Can I say it again? Write it down. You only invest in what stands the test. Your faith is as prosperous as what it survives. People will give you if you came through something. Because that test creates trust. If you're steady, they're going to bring things to you. Stay steady, son. Stay faithful. That's the good part. And each of them gave him a piece of money and what? A ring of gold. And the Lord blessed the latter days of Job. Latter means after the storm. Tell your neighbor there are days after the storm. Say it again. There's days after the storm, mama. Come on, say there's days after the storm. You see, this too will pass because there's days after this. Let me say something about, this is very important. Let me say something about suicide in case some of y'all got some thoughts. Suicide is a permanent solution to a temporary problem. It ain't worth it. There are days after the problem. So stay alive until the storm passes. Give God a praise. Don't try to solve a temporary problem with a permanent solution. That's what Judas did. Christ would have forgiven him. He forgave Peter. There might have been a gospel according to Judas. But he took a permanent solution for a temporary problem. Who haven't you betrayed? And they forgave you. And you're still living. Who haven't betrayed you? And you still go on. And they still go on. After. What does it say? After the latter days. The Lord blessed him more than his beginning. And it lists some of the things he got back. 14,000 sheep. He only had 7 at first. 6,000 camels. 1,000 yoke oxen. 1,000 female donkeys. That means there's male donkeys around. He had also 7 sons and 3 daughters. He got his son's children back. That means he got a new wife. Praise the Lord. Everybody say praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let me tell you something. You better stay faithful in the storm. Because why? You may lose the blessing on the other side of the storm. You understand me? Yeah. You go through a tough time. You know, the business ain't going too well and the construction. And she get all uptight. You made the money. She divorced you. And then in 7 years, there's some construction company 7 times bigger than it was. And then she lock. Now she married to a dumb fellow who can't do nothing. You got to stay with him through the storm. That's what he's saying. You got to stay with him. That woman lost Job. Yes. And she lost 7 times the amount of blessing. Tell your neighbor, stay with it. On the other side, there's 7 times more. Give God a praise. There's 7 times more. Hallelujah. And in all the land, Verse 15. There was no woman so beautiful as Job's daughters. And their father gave them an inheritance, verse 15, among their brothers. And after this, Job lived 140 years. After the storm? No, don't commit suicide in the pressure. Don't quit. Don't leave now. 140 years after. Boy, I figure, you know, if I was Job, I'd have kicked the bucket a long time. This, you know, boils, wife gone, children gone, house burned, you know, everything. Hey, forget this. Bang. God says, no, there's 140 years after this event. That's why I came to talk to you today. You ain't saying nothing yet. And what Satan meant for evil, God's about to show off and give us seven times more what we thought we had to go through. Give God the biggest shout. Stand up on your feet and give him praise this morning. Celebrate the Lord God. If you believe, then you act like you believe. The fight is for your belief. Tell your neighbor, it ain't working. He can't touch my belief. My faith is in God. My faith is in the rock. Come on, give God a big praise this morning. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I asked the Holy Spirit on my bed last night in Florida. I said, Lord, how do I close the meeting tomorrow? He says, I want you to create a hedge around everyone going through a test. And then he showed me a scripture. When Peter said, Lord, I will never leave you. I will die for you. And Jesus said, Peter, Satan has just demanded to test you and to sift those words to see if you're going to pass the test. And then Jesus said, I can't stop the test, but I've prayed for your faith.
Thank you once again for listening to this message, as we hope that it has been a blessing to you. Our goal is to show you new paths and opportunities so that you can discover your purpose. It is your love, support, and partnership that makes Munroe Global possible. Please visit us online at www.munroeglobal.com for more product, partnership, or to join us at one of our live events around the world.